It's important to know that quantum electrical circuits are very different of usual quantum systems using quantum information processing. So there one usually deals with single atoms, trapped ions, photons, so in general microscopic objects, the kind of objects that were actually essential in establishing quantum theory. So I would say relatively simple microscopic objects in general. Now, our physical systems are relatively large objects. So we deal with nanostructures, the nanostructures, superconductors with typical sizes in the micron or submicron range. So these structures contain typically 10 to the power 9, 10 to the power 10 atoms. So they have a relatively complicated structure. Luckily, it turns out, and this is the result of research over the last few decades, it turns out that these systems can be described in a very simple way, and this comes about through the magic of superconductivity. So it's superconductivity which turns these relatively messy and complex systems into well-behaved quantum objects at low temperature. So this is the outline of my talk. As I said, I will spend quite a bit of time talking about principles of quantum superconducting circuits. Then I'll motivate why these systems are interesting for quantum computing. And also explain how superconducting circuits became very interesting test beds for applications in quantum optics. So I think it's fair to say that it really pushes quantum optics in a new regime where you can look at very strong interaction between single atoms and light. So this will really be the main part of my talk, and then I will spend a bit of time talking about some recent research done by our group, and also actually the first topic is in collaboration with my former group in the Netherlands. So we came up with a new idea for a 2-qubit gate, and we applied it to superconducting circuits. And the second topic will address more this quantum optics domain. So I'll talk about detecting microwave photons with multi-destruction. So let me start with what will be probably for most of you just a reminder on what superconductivity is, or just get some really very basic notions. So if you take a metal at regular temperatures, the electronic system is characterized by finite charge conductivity. There is not much electron out there, and also there is no energy gap for exciting the electrons. So it takes really a very tiny amount of energy to excite an electron. When you go below a transition temperature, which is for the metal that we use to produce our devices, which is aluminum, this temperature is 1.2 Kelvin, something quite spectacular happens. So the electron state changes quite dramatically, and the first consequence of that change is infinite conductivity, which is not strictly speaking correct in low frequencies, but at very low frequencies this is practically the case. Then the electrons also become older. So the electrons involved in charge transport, those near the Fermi sea, become get to be combined in the so-called Cooper pair. So these two electrons come together. So there is electron order. And then there is also a gap, an excitation gap arises. So it takes a finite amount of energy to excite the electrons, and that energy is actually proportional. So now it turns out that this gap for electron hole excitations survives as well in very small electromagnetic fields or in fields of low frequency. But what we are interested in is another type of excitation, lower energy excitations below the gap, which come about when we bring in not only superconductors but also weak links in superconductors, so-called Josephson junctions. And it turns out that these low energy excitations have an anharmonic spectrum, and the typical energy scales that I'll introduce shortly are the so-called Josephson energy. So all the devices that we are going to look at contain at least a single Josephson junction. The Josephson junction is such a sandwich structure formed by two superconductors interrupted by a thin panel carrier, which is a dielectric. To describe the quantum state of this junction, you can simply label it by the number of Cooper pairs that are on either side of the barrier. So you would start with N1 Cooper pairs on the left side and N2 Cooper pairs on the right side, and then you have to allow for a finite number of Cooper pairs, lowercase n here, to cross the barrier from left to right. So when you are in the limit of a thick barrier, the states with different n are degenerate, so not you can think of this as one couple of states, so not much happens when you move one Cooper pair from one side to another. But in the limit of a thin barrier, this degeneracy is lifted, and this is described very well by this following Hamiltonian. So you see such terms in which a state with n Cooper pairs having crossed the barrier evolves into a state with n plus 1 Cooper pairs having crossed the barrier, and you have the opposite process as well, so n plus 1 Cooper pairs on this side evolves into a state with only n Cooper pairs on this side, so 1 Cooper pair goes back. And you have this this constant here, the Josson energy. So now to understand the consequences which arise from this Hamiltonian, it's very instructive to look at the analogy with the solid state model for a crystal, the so-called pi binding model for a crystal, in this case a one-dimensional crystal. So this model basically consists of a regular lattice site as you have in solids, and then assuming that electrons can be on any of these sites, but they have also some finite probability to move to neighboring sites. And it's a relatively simple exercise in solid state theory to show that the energy level structure is given by such a relation. So E of gamma is proportional to cosine of gamma, where gamma is a parameter for this quantum state. So each state gamma is a square position with equal probabilities of different n states by different phase factors. So this looks actually like a Fourier transform. And now again, following the analogy with solid state, we can derive the two basic constitutive relations of a Josson junction. In a crystal, the number of Cooper pairs is replaced by the position x, and that phase gamma that I showed earlier is replaced by the crystal momentum of an electron. So now if you form a wave packet with position centered around x, that position will evolve in time, so there will be a velocity which is proportional to the energy, to the derivative of the energy with respect to k. And then if you apply an addition of force, so a tilt in this potential, then the crystal momentum will vary in time with the derivative proportional to that force. And now you can just move this to the case of a Josson junction, take the analogous quantities, and first look at charge transport as opposed to change in position space. So charge transport is equivalent to a current. This current is proportional to the derivative of that energy phase relation that I have shown earlier. So there was a cosine there. So now I have that you're obtained that the current is proportional to sinus of gamma. And this proportionality constant depends on the Josson energy I introduced. And then you can obtain the second Josson relation as well by looking at the voltage that you apply across that junction, which is the equivalent of a force. So this second Josson relation connects the voltage V to the time derivative of the phase gamma. And these two relations in which you have voltage and current bring already forward this idea of an electrical circuit. And it turns out that actually can describe this Josson junction simply as an electrical circuit element, which is very helpful when you deal with more complicated systems of this type. In order to do that, you can start with a second Josson relation which connects the voltage to the time derivative of the phase gamma, and then you define a quantity, the branch flux, which is simply the time integral of the voltage. And this is just analogous to a regular inductor where the derivative of the flux is proportional to the voltage. So now if you put these two together, you obtain that this so-called branch flux is proportional to the phase gamma, with the proportionality constant being a fundamental constant, the Planck quantum, which is the Planck constant derived by 2E. And if you also bring in the first Josson relation, you end up with this formula here. So you see that the current is related to the flux, and this type of relation is indeed characteristic of an inductor, which in this case is actually a non-linear inductor. In the limit when this branch flux is very small, you can linearize this relation, and the proportionality constant coming up is the inverse of this Josson relation. again related to fundamental constants. Now there's another ingredient you have to bring in. So when you look at charge transport through the Jesson junction, there is the possibility of Cooper pairs crossing the barrier, but you also have the possibility of Cooper pairs accumulating close to this barrier. So and you can think of this as being some sort of parallel plate capacitor system. So the accumulation of charge close to the barrier results in a new term in the energy coming in, which can be properly described by this relation, so Q squared divided by 2C. And if you pull out of the total charge Q, the number of, so the total charge being the number of Cooper pairs M times the 2 times the electron charge, then you, there is another energy scale coming in, which is this factor here. This is called the charging energy. So at the end, you can describe a single Jesson junction using a simple circuit-like representation, which is schematized here. So you have a channel for flow of charge through tunneling of Cooper pairs, which is this branch of the circuit, and then you have this capacitance channel. And you've seen that this energy can be described in classical terms, but those classical variables become in the end quantum operators. So you have the number of charges and the phase gamma coming in. Then you have this proportionality constant, these energy scales that I mentioned, the charging energy and the Jesson energy. And gamma and n are conjugate variables, so they're commutator design. So this is very analogous to position and momentum of a particle. It turns out that it's very easy to calculate the energy level structure of this system. So actually, very surprisingly, it turns out that many relevant calculations of energy level structure and so on are actually much simpler than for atoms, where we really have to look very often at very fine effects in order to do what you want with atoms. So here, very often you can do a lot with a simple numerical or semi-analytical calculation. And this shows the energy level structure of a typical Jesson junction. So what I show here is the shape of the potential energy and then the ladder of energy levels, so E0, E1, and so on. And this energy level structure is almost harmonic, but not quite. So if you look at this energy level splitting, it's actually a bit larger than this other one. So the system is slightly anharmonic. And this is actually sufficient to build a quantum bit at this point, because you can simply access this transition without inducing transition from the first to the second excited state. It turns out that this is not a very good qubit, so it's actually not used as a qubit. You have to do something a bit more sophisticated than that to get a good qubit. And now it's also useful to look at this table, which shows the phase and charge like variables and parameters in circuits with Jesson junctions. So I introduce already the phase gamma and the number of quarters and the two fundamental constants. Then you have these mesoscopic constants, and these are called mesoscopic because they are not fundamental. So they aren't anything like the electron charge or the fine structure constant that you have for regular atoms. These are really parameters that you can choose at will. So you can just change these by changing sizes in your circuit. So it's really a matter of design. However, these parameters enter the description of quantum properties of these circuits just as well as fundamental constants do for real atoms. So this is also a reason why these systems are called artificial atoms very, very often. And then it's also useful to look at energy scales. So Jesson energy is typically varies typically from 10s to 1,000 gigahertz, and the charging energy varies typically from below 1 gigahertz to 50 gigahertz. So now, as I said, in order to get useful qubits, you have to do something a bit more sophisticated, and I will just explain to you briefly how the main type of system we are looking at works. So we look at the so-called flux qubits, and this is an atomic force microscope picture of our qubit. So what you can see here is this flat area, which is simply a silicon substrate, and the actual qubit is formed by evaporation of two thin aluminum layers on top of that substrate. So you can see these shadows here coming from the two different layers. And just as on junctions are these overlap regions coming up here, so you have two layers of aluminum on top of each other, and in between you have this dielectric, and this together form the Josephson junction. The actual qubit is this ring over here. So the two states, the two lower states of the qubit are characterized by circulating currents flowing in either of the two directions, so clockwise or anti-clockwise. And the rest of the device is actually DC squid used to measure the state of the quantum beam. So in order to calculate the energy level structure of this system, you have to make up a simple circuit model for the flux qubit. So you take into account three Josephson junctions. You've seen four in the device picture, but this is a bit of a technical detail. But here you have three Josephson junctions. You assign a degree of freedom to each of those three Josephson junctions, so the phases gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. Then you can actually relate the 3 degrees of freedom to the magnetic flux applied to this loop. So with regular atoms, you have different control knobs to change the quantum state. So you can use electric fields, magnetic fields. In this case, we only have one control knob, which is the magnetic flux applied to this ring. So for this relation, and then when you write down the charging energy and the Josephson energy for the entire structure, you can actually derive a Lagrangian, just as you do in analytical mechanics, and then use canonical quantization to move from classical variables to operators. And once you have the quantum description, you can calculate all the properties you want. So I'm not going through the details, but the point is that there is a relatively simple and well-established recipe to go from any network with Josephson junctions to a full quantum description. And the result of a typical energy level structure calculation is shown here. So this is a plot of energy as a function of the control parameter, which is the magnetic flux. This only takes a few seconds, basically. So it's in that sense that I say that it's relatively straightforward to do these calculations. So now if you focus on these two energy levels here, this is your actual qubit. So you use the ground state and the first excited state as the two levels of the qubit. And the Hamiltonian in that reduced Hilbert space can be described very accurately by this relation. So you have two terms proportional to the sigma x and sigma z. Pauli operators. In these terms, you have the so-called design parameters, which depend on sizes of Josephson junctions and so on, and then you also have your control parameters. So now, you've seen quite a few talks about quantum computing. So, quantum computing basically employs quantum systems, so ensembles of quantum bits, which are two-level systems, to perform computations. So, in a qubit, you use not only states 0 and 1 to store information, but also superpositions thereof. And then you can extend this notion of the notion of a classical register. So start with the register, and you can obtain, you can go to a quantum register, which can live in this superposition of all the possible states. And then the analog of a gate for a classical computer is the unitary evolution of your many qubit system. So this is again a question that was addressed in many talks, so I'm not going to go into any detail here. So if you ask this question, how much better is a quantum computer than a classical computer? There is no general answer, and actually this is very much work in progress, and we very much hope that there will be more development there. But what is clear at this time is that there are problems such as factoring, search, and quantum simulation, which will potentially be solved much faster by quantum computers than by using classical computers. And the question is at what cost? And the cost will be huge. It's not only about money here, it's about everything. So when you think about building a quantum computer, this will be without doubt a very difficult task, and because you really have to push much farther everything that was achieved up to this point in terms of controlling, isolating, and measuring quantum systems. And if you want to measure how good a quantum computer is, or how good a quantum computer would be, then you can use the so-called DiVincenzo criteria. So you need a well-defined physical system. So basically, well-defined qubits, which can also be put together. Because you need many qubits eventually, so you need to be able to control many qubits at once. You need to be able to initialize the qubits in a well-defined state. You need long decoherence time, so I'll explain shortly what decoherence is and what are the specific features in the case of quantum qubits. Then you need a universal set of quantum gates and a measurement capability for your qubit. So how do you, the first step is initialization of qubits. How do you do that? That's actually pretty simple, so we really use the brute force method for superconducting qubits. So the energy level splittings are in the gigahertz range, and if we simply cool down the qubits to a temperature below 30 millikelvin, which can be achieved conveniently using dilution refrigeration technology, then this temperature corresponds to an energy which is a factor of a few at least below the typical energy level splitting. So if you just allow the qubit to relax, you actually can prepare the ground state within the relaxation time, which is also relatively fast, a few microseconds, with very high fidelity. So the fidelity is basically given by the Boltzmann factor, and it can exceed easily 99%. So this is easy. Then, what about quantum gates? So, in order to be able to build any type of quantum gate on a system of qubits, you need to combine single qubit gates and two qubit gates. So for single qubit gates, a discrete set is sufficient, but in general, if you have continuous sets, this can be better, and I will show briefly how we do this. Then you also need a two-qubit gate, and for example, the so-called quantum control node, so the C-node gate is sufficient for that purpose. So what is a C-node gate? So this is a gate in which the state of the, so if you take qubit 1, shown in blue, and qubit 2, shown in red, the state of the second qubit is flipped if the first qubit was in state 1. So this is the truth table of these gates. So 1-0 will go to 1-1, and 1-1 will go to 1-0. Whereas if the first qubit was in state 0, the second qubit will be in state 1. And we do this simply using resonant driving. So we take the Hamiltonian of the qubit in the energy eigenbasis, so minus half delta sigma z, and then we drive with a frequency omega close to this resonance. So the driving Hamiltonian is orthogonal to the qubit Hamiltonian. And if you look at the evolution in the rotating frame, so the frame in which you remove the phase evolving, the phase which accumulates simply as a result of the energy level splitting delta of the qubit, then the evolution operator is given by this expression here. So you see that you have a combination of sigma x and sigma y, which is what makes this gate universal. And for example, if you take the evolution after time pi divided by a, you get the evolution operator sigma x, so this is the state of the qubit. This is a measurement done already a few years ago on a single qubit. So this shows the population of the ground. When I say population, actually it's a single qubit. So what you do is you prepare the system many times, you apply the same evolution operator, and you measure the state, and you extract the average value out of that. So that's this average value plotted as a function of the time, as a function of the evolution time. And you see this continuous change between the ground and the excited state. And I'm also using this just to comment briefly on measurement, because I'll not say much more about this. Already at that time, it was possible to measure the state of a single qubit with close to 90% fidelity, which was pretty good. And in the meantime, there's been more development. So it really there are a few measurement schemes which give results quite a bit beyond 90%. So this is more or less a solved problem, at least for this stage. So now, what about decoherence? So first of all, what is decoherence? This is the process for which a qubit loses its pure state it started in as a result of the interaction with the environment. So after the qubit and the environment have been put in contact, it's not possible to describe their common quantum state as a separable state. You need a density matrix to describe the state of the qubit, which is fine, so you can still predict expectation values of operators and so on. But it is a problem for quantum computing, because for quantum computers, you need to work with pure states. And how do you describe the coherence? You can use master equations, which is something that was discussed in Edel in one of the talks here. This is a certain limit of that master equation. It does involve the Bohm-Markov approximation and so on. So there are some approximations involved, but it turns out that for superconducting qubits in general, it is a good description. And I'm not going to go through the details here, but what I want to say basically is that there are a few time scales that you can use to characterize the coherence. So there is first of all the relaxation time. So basically this is the time after which the qubit prepared in the excited state evolves towards the ground state gradually. And then there is dephasing time, which describes the damping of the off-diagonal terms of the density matrix. And dephasing arises, first of all, from the same channel that leads to energy relaxation, but also arises from low-frequency noise. So low-frequency noise, which is unfortunately present in all mesoscopic devices, leads to additional dephasing. And overall, dephasing is characterized by this T2 timescale, with the dephasing rate being the sum of the rate coming from relaxation and magnetic factor 2 round here. Sorry about it. And then you have this pure dephasing contribution. And the key point is that you want the operation time divided by the coherence time to be smaller than the error threshold. So the error threshold is the error beyond which you cannot correct for errors in a quantum computer. And this is a very complex topic in itself. Let me just say that depending on the architecture of the quantum computer, this error threshold may vary between 10 to the minus 4 and 10 to the minus 2. It turns out that at this stage, superconducting qubits are not quite within this range, but they are very close to the few percent level when you look at single qubit gates in particular. 1% is achievable at this point. With two qubit gates, you have typically 2% error. So we're really not that far in terms of these metrics. But this is just... I think it's still a relatively superficial point of view in the sense that when you want to scale up, you need to look at other issues as well. And another point which is important is that for superconducting qubits, very often relaxation and pure dephasing come from independent sources. So what you are trying to do in general is make T1 as long as possible. Eventually, it is limited by microscopic systems or let's say microscopic features of the environment. And then you need to fight to make the dephasing time much larger than the T1 time, much longer than the relaxation time. And with this, I will conclude that this part on quantum computing. So then maybe just let me summarize by saying that superconducting systems are seen as one of the main candidates at this point for quantum computing, and it's this feature that makes them interesting, namely the fact that you can build them. So it's a completely different approach. It's very similar to what was done in microelectronics for decades, in which it's the top down approach in which you really pattern your system to have the properties you need. So this is what drives largely that effort. Now, let me say a few things about another area of research in which superconducting qubits have turned out to be quite relevant, which is quantum optics. So when you think of quantum optics, you think of the basic processes which describe interaction of atoms with light. And we all know from undergrad courses about spontaneous emission, absorption, and stimulated emission. And an interesting question, and this again came up in some of the previous talks, is what happens when you look at this phenomena in this kind of setting. So you start with a waveguide, a one-dimensional waveguide for light. So you can think, okay, the reason for having these field lines here, I'm not going to explain that in much detail, but just think of light propagating along this direction in this structure. So it can only run along this direction. And then you can disturb propagation by building semi-transparent mirrors, if you wish, and for our cavities, these are basically just obtained by breaking this line here. So now, what happens if you look at emission of an atom which is prepared to start in the excited state? So now you can think of this of the photon actually going sideways in both directions because there's no given the symmetry of the situation, propagation should go both ways. But then there is reflection at these boundaries here, and then when photons come back, they must interfere, and depending on what that interference leads to, you can have two different regimes. So if interference is destructive, that basically means that the process is forbidden, because you combine amplitudes, quantum amplitudes, which have a vanishing effect. So another way of saying that is that emission of the atom is inhibited, and this is what comes under the name of the Poisson effect. Now, if interference is instead constructive, the result is emission-absorption cycles. So basically, the atom would emit a photon, then reabsorb it, and then re-emit it, and so on and so forth. And there is a more rigorous way to describe this, which is the James Cummings Hamiltonian. So you take your two systems, the two-level system, and then this cavity, so this resonator that I've shown there, which is a bosonic mode, so it has state 0, 1, 2, and so on. And if you prepare the atom in state E and the cavity in state 0, then given the fact that due to the coupling, this is not an energy eigenstate, you obtain these vacuum radio oscillations in which one point of excitation is transferred periodically to the cavity and then comes back to the atom. So these are two ways to think of the same thing. So now, this kind of physics has been studied in atomic physics for a very long time now. And it came under the name of cavity quantum electrodynamics in that case. So someone dubbed another name for this in the case of superconducting devices. So it's called circuit quantum electrodynamics. And other than a different name, there's actually a much better reason why this is interesting. And this is because we deal with the domain of the of light, which is actually not even usually considered light. So these frequencies in the range of gigahertz are not usually perceived as light. But the fact that you have this quantum behavior of atoms brought together with light means that you can access more of the quantum properties of the light in a completely different frequency domain. And then another interest comes from the fact that at this microwave frequencies of tens of gigahertz, it's much easier to build structures which confine light. So as a result, the electromagnetic field is much stronger and therefore couples more strongly to the atom. Now I'd like to move on to say a bit about some recent research that we've been doing. And let me start with a topic pertaining to quantum computing, which is a demonstration of a new type of two-qubit gate. So we want to build gates for flux qubits, and I should say the principle is actually quite general. So what we'll show here applies to basically any type of superconducting qubit. But if you think of flux qubits in particular, so this is a device in which you have two flux qubits. So these two loops are twisted here for more technical reasons. But the essential point is that each qubit has a magnetic is characterized by a persistent current, and that current results in magnetic flux, which is fed to the other qubit. So this is how the two qubits feel each other, if you want. Now, there is a formal way in which you can describe this interaction. So you put together the Hamiltonians of the two qubits, so delta 1, sigma z1, epsilon 1, sigma x1, and then the same for the second qubit. And then the interaction, which is sigma x1, sigma x2, and you have this proportionality constant here. For the orders of magnitude, it's important to know that J is usually smaller than delta 1 and delta 2, but can be made comparable with these two parameters, whereas epsilon is fully tunable from 0 up to values that can be much larger than delta 1 and delta 2. And let's start by looking at the case in which epsilon is much larger than delta. So this is away from the symmetry point, where by symmetry point I mean the point where epsilon is equal to 0. And in this limit, you can write the Hamiltonian in this form. So you have half epsilon 1 sigma x1 plus half epsilon 2 sigma x2. Okay, there is a minus sign there. And then j sigma x1 sigma x2. So if you look at the energy levels now, you can start by looking at the two isolated systems, so qubit 1, which stays 0 and 1, and then qubit 2, which stays 0 and 1 as well. And then you bring the two systems together. At first, if you neglect the coupling, then the energy levels are given by this dashed line here. So these are just the combination frequencies from the two systems. But when you bring the coupling in, these levels are repelled. The energy eigenstates do not really change because this interaction Hamiltonian commutes with the system Hamiltonian. And now, given this energy level structure, the question is, how do you do a two-qubit gate? And the answer is actually quite simple. You use frequency selectivity. So it turns out that this energy level splitting is different of this energy level splitting. So now, if you shine light which is resonant with this transition, that will induce an oscillation on this transition, but not on this transition over here. So if the first qubit is prepared in state 1, so if the blue qubit is prepared in state 1, then the second qubit will undergo oscillation. And if you start that oscillation in time, you can realize a bit flip on the second qubit. So this is what gives C0 gate. So this is pretty simple. It has also been demonstrated experimentally, but there is a problem with that, and that has to do with decoherence. So if you look at the energy level, at the energy levels of the qubit as functional magnetic flux, which is what I've shown previously, you see that the energy difference goes through a minimum at this symmetry point, so the point where the magnetic flux is equal to half of first quantum. And it's actually essential to operate at that point because, unfortunately, in these devices, there is a lot of excess flux noise, and this is a very complicated topic. Basically, it's not really understood where flux noise comes from, but it's always there, and you have to do something to avoid it. And you avoid it simply by staying here, where fluctuations of flux do not result in very strong fluctuations in energy. Whereas if you are here, the conversion between fluctuations of magnetic flux and energy is much higher. And this and the effect of this has been shown very nicely in some experiments, for example, in this paper, where the dephasing rate shown by the empty dots here is plotted as a function of the distance between the symmetry point and the operation point. And you can see that the dephasing rate goes to a very sharp minimum at this symmetry point. So you really want to be there in order to have the optimal coherence properties. But the question is, how do you do quantum gates over there? So now the Hamiltonian, when you take epsilon to be 0, has this structure. So you have delta 1, sigma z1, delta 2, sigma z2, and then this interaction term. So again, you start with the uncoupled levels, and then the uncoupled energies are given just as previously by these dashed lines. But now the coupling Hamiltonian has a very different structure. So it actually couples these two intermediate levels and then the lowest and the highest level. And level repulsion results in an energy level structure where these two transitions are now degenerate. So you cannot use the same idea as previously to implement the controlled NOT gate, because if you shine radiation resonant with this transition is on as well. So you don't have that frequency selectivity property that removes this transition. Now, how do you deal with that? Well, it turns out that luckily, you can deal with it by doing something a bit more special with the way in which you drive the system. So let's take again the Hamiltonians for the two qubits and then the driving term, where in this case, and this is the essential point, driving actually is done at the same frequency on the two qubits, so it has the same frequency, the same driving frequency omega applied to the two qubits. However, the driving amplitude and phase can be tuned individually for each qubit. And now we calculate the matrix elements for these driving operators between two energy eigenstates. And let's look at a certain limit just for simplicity. In fact, the principle applies to all cases. But if you look at this limit where the coupling J is much smaller than the difference between the two deltas, where deltas are the qubits, then the energy levels are given approximately. I put an equal sign here, but the right sign is approximately. So the energy levels are given approximately by this relation. So 0, 0 remains basically 0, 0, 1, 1 remains 1, 1. However, 0, 1, for example, is 0, 1 with a bit of admixture from 1, 0, whereas 1, 0 tilde, the new energy eigenstate, is 1, 0 with a bit of admixture from 0, 1. So now, when you calculate the matrix elements using this relation here, you find that these are combinations of J deltas A1, A2, and the two phases. But interestingly, it turns out that if you choose properly the ratio between A1 and A2, and if you also choose properly the two phases, you can actually completely cancel this one, whereas this one is non-vanishing, and moreover proportional with your driving. So basically, this symmetry, which in a way you can think of this as being the result of symmetry being broken by the application of the radiation. So even though that symmetry of the coupling resulted in equal transition frequencies, now by applying the driving in the proper way, you can actually remove this problem of degenerate frequencies. And we've shown this in experiments, and the experiments run as follows. So you start by applying a pulse to the first qubit. So this is this blue pulse here, which basically changes the state of the first qubit alone. And then you apply a second pulse, this time both to both qubit 1 and 2 with the proper frequency. And at the end, you measure the population, or let's say the probabilities to find the two qubits in either of their states. So the role of the first pulse is to create a superposition of the 0 and 1 states, whereas the second pulse induces a rotation of the state of the second qubit, which depends on the state of the qubit 1. So, and in general, based on what I showed earlier, these oscillations between 0, 0, and 0, 1, 1,0 and 1,1 should occur at different rates. And we measure those rates basically, so we look at real-time oscillations and take the Fourier transform of those oscillations in order to extract the oscillation frequencies of the two qubits. And the result is shown in this graph here. So the color is basically where you get the max, the Fourier spectrum. And this is shown as a function of the driving strength for each qubit. This is shown as a function of the two phases applied, the phases of the drive applied to the two qubits. And you can see that you have two distinct frequencies which correspond to these two transitions which are degenerate. And indeed, they turn out to be different. So the oscillation 0, 0 to 0, 1 and the 1, 0 to 1, 1 oscillations come at different frequencies. And by properly tuning this phase difference between the two drives, you can actually completely remove one of those two transitions. So the Rabi frequency, the oscillation frequency for that transition becomes 0. And now, if you look at this properly in real time, you see that, for example, if you take the time for which you apply radiation to the first qubit to be 0, so basically you leave the first qubit in the ground state, then there is nothing happening to the second qubit, so no oscillation taking place. Whereas if you prepare the first qubit in the excited state, then there are oscillations in the state of the second qubit. So this shows that this principle works indeed. And now I should say that there have been other attempts to solve this problem of doing a gate between two qubits at a symmetry point. And one used an additional copper element. So this was another superconducting device placed between the two qubits, which would be act as a copper modulated in time. So this is a so-called parametric modulation scheme, and the second scheme comes under more complicated acronym flick fork, and it involves a more subtle effect in which you drive the two qubits and you actually arrange things in such a way that the oscillation frequencies get to match the energy level difference between the two qubits. Well, okay, I definitely don't have enough time to explain this too, but let me just say that the advantage of our scheme is that, first of all, there is no additional coupler element that needs to be brought in as you need for the case of the parametric coupling scheme. So you actually can do both single qubit gates and two qubit gates using one control channel for each qubit. So this is one advantage. And then the other advantage is that if you look at the time it takes to do a gate, that time is not limited by J, actually. It's not limited by the coupling strength. It's only limited by the difference between these two frequencies, which can be more or less chosen. So this is another nice feature, the fact that we can do this extremely fast, which is important if you want to improve your gate fidelity. But there are also some problems. So first of all, in this implementation, the coherence times were not very good, even at the symmetry points of the qubit, and that is related to some details in which is about the circuit itself. And then also, the implementation chosen in the experiment that I've shown here implied two qubits that were placed next to each other. So the qubits feel each other, but it's only if they are placed very close to each other. So if you want to extend this to many qubits, you cannot couple qubits that are not placed, that basically which are not neighbors. So what we are trying to do now is basically deal with both of these problems, and we want to work with this architecture. So we want to place two of these qubits, and actually not only two, but let me start by explaining the principle with two qubits. So you place these two qubits in a microwave cavity. So now what is happening is that each qubit interacts with the cavity, not so much with the other qubit. However, given the fact that they both interact with cavity, there is an effective interaction arising between these two quantum systems. And this effective interaction can be calculated. It has this expression here, so it's proportional to the coupling factor of each qubit to the cavity, and then the tuning between the qubit energies and the cavities. And the essential point here is that you get this interaction, it has the form you want, it has a large enough amplitude, and as I've actually said, the amplitude is not really even so important for this scheme because the gate speed is not really related to J. So what we hope now is by using more of these qubits in the cavity that you can scale this principle up to a system with a few qubits. And what we like about it is that it's really economical. So what you need is to bring in a control line close to each qubit, but it's only one control channel per qubit, which makes it really very interesting. So with this, I'd like to conclude this part and move to the last part of my talk, which is basically related to quantum optics applications of superconducting circuits. So I'll talk about detection of microwave photons. And let me start by pointing to the features of regular photon detectors. So this is a schematic representation of regular photon detectors. So you have a PN structure, so a semiconducting structure. You apply the proper potential such that when an electron comes and creates an electron hole there, the electric field will draw the electron and hole in opposite sides, and then there is an avalanche process taking place, which results in enough charge to be detected by suitable electronics. But now, there are some features which are usually taken for granted, but which are not really fundamental limitations in principle. So what is happening is that each time you have a photon coming in, that photon is absorbed. So you irreversibly lose that single photon once you have detected it. Then the second feature is that states with one or more photons are actually not distinguishable. So if you have one, two, or three photons, you're going to get a signal, but it's going to be the same signal in general. So the question is, can you actually do better than this? And in order to address this question, you have to turn to quantum measurement theory and basically understand whether measurements without absorption are possible. The answer comes from the so-called quantum non-demolition measurement. So this is something that probably I will not be able to explain very properly in a brief time, but the basic idea would run as follows. So you have the system you want to measure, which is your photon mode. So this system is characterized basically by the number of photons you have in that mode. And then you have your meter, which is coupled to this photon mode, and the meter has in its structure a way to point to the different number of photons in this mode after some suitable interaction took place. Now, if you look at this as a combined quantum system, it is obviously a very complex system, and the complexity arises, of course, due to the meter, because the system we want to measure is a very simple system. So now, it turns out that you can say actually a great deal about the quantum measurement process, even if you disregard the details of the Hamiltonian of the meter. So So if you only look at the system Hamiltonian and then the interaction, you can already say quite a bit about what is happening when you measure this quantum system. And it turns out that if you measure this N operator, so the number of photons in this mode, then what you want in order to do a proper and clean measurement is that the eigenstates of N are preserved throughout the measurement. And this, as a result of really very basic quantum mechanics principles, will always happen when N commutes with the system Hamiltonian. This is trivially correct in this case because you do measure the system Hamiltonian, so the Hamiltonian is proportional to the number of quanta. And then you also require that N commutes with the interaction Hamiltonian, which is the part that becomes more difficult because then you need to find the proper interaction which guarantees that condition. But now, if you have these two conditions fulfilled, what you can say is that you measure, you look at N, and then if your meter can tell you even a tiny bit about the difference between different N states, and so if you can extract any information at all, that's fine, and actually you can tell something about the system without really changing the population of the different N states. So there is no change in the expectation value taking place during the measurement, which means that you can do the measurement without absorbing the photons. But when you say without absorbing, it doesn't mean that the state doesn't change. The state does change. However, it doesn't change in the direction where you, on average, after many measurements, you lose photons. So you can actually do this in optics, and this employs the so-called fair non-linearity. So say you have an optical beam that you want to measure. So you pass this beam through a cross-scale medium. That beam will induce a change in the refraction index of the medium, and that change can be measured using an interferometric setup. So what you do is you bring in another beam, you use a beam splitter, you pass part of the beam through this cross-scale medium, then you recombine it with part of the initial beam, and you measure the result. And that should tell you something about the phase, the optical path for this medium. So something about the refractive index, and eventually something about number. So formally, the Hamiltonian has this form. So it's proportional to the number of photons in this beam and the number of photons in this beam. This obviously commutes with the number of photons with the operator corresponding to the number of photons you want to measure, NS. So you do have what you need for quantum on demolition measurements. However, it turns out that the interaction is in general very, very weak. So then other detail comes in which basically conspire in making this not efficient enough to measure single photons. So you can tell the difference between a large number of photons and a larger number of photons, but not between 0 and 1 photons or 1 and 2 photons. So now, the question we looked at was how can you design such an interaction with superconducting circuits? And we actually use a system that has been around for a long time, maybe the most, the best known superconducting device. It's a DC squid, so a superconducting ring with two Josephson junctions. And we basically use two DC squids coupled to each other to implement this kind of Hamiltonian. So, one squid, the squid number one, acts as a detector. So this squid is an inductor with the inductance depending on the magnetic flux fed to that ring. And in order to measure the inductance and hence the flux, we build a resonator. So we look at how the resonance frequency of this system depends on the applied magnetic flux. And then the other part of the circuit is again a squid, and this is the squid where we store the photons that we want to measure. So now, this is again a resonator. So the squid is a nonlinear inductor, and then you have a capacitor in parallel with it. And what is happening is that if you have a current going in this circuit through the squid, then that current will result in a circulating current here, which will rise quadratically with the current that you feed through the squid. So you can say in a way that the squid acts as an inductor, so that acts as a converter of a linear signal to something which is quadratic. So something which is linear here becomes the second power of that signal when you look at this screening current. So you can measure actually fluctuations of a quantity directly if you look at the screening current. And you do that using this first grid that I introduced. So now the system will look overall like this. So this is the system that we want to measure. This is our detector. We have an interaction between those two. And basically, it turns out you have to write down properly the Hamiltonian for this circuit, and it is relatively complicated, but we can come up with an effective Hamiltonian which has this form. Even the effective Hamiltonian has many terms in it, but I will ask you to focus on the terms in red here. So you have a term which is proportional to A dagger A. So that's the number of photons in the detector. And then a term proportional to B dagger B. So this is the operator corresponding to the number of photons that you want to measure. And then you have this nonlinear interaction, which is a number-number interaction, which gives you what you need in order to do measurements of the photons in this N. And a large part of this work was actually to study how strong this interaction can be. And it turns out, okay, this is again a relatively complicated expression, but it turns out that G in the end can be as large as the product of the two, so basically the geometric mean of the two frequencies, and then divided by the product of the number of photons operators and taking the product of this quantity here. And basically this quantity is the maximum number of photons that can be held within each resonator. So the problem is that these systems are not linear, so you cannot store an infinite number of photons because at some point some approximations will break. So it turns out that the larger the number of photons you want to store, the smaller this coupling factor is. However, what we're happy about is that we came up with a relation which has a very nice fundamental flavor to it. So basically, you have a coupling factor between two nonlinear oscillators. That coupling factor can be as strong as the geometric mean of the two frequencies. However, that is reduced when the system becomes more and more linear. And it turns out that we can actually, based on present technology, we can hope to be able to detect up to 10 photons, so really tell the difference between 0, 1, 2, and so on, up to 10 photons, with more than 80% fidelity, with even if we use, as I said, conventional technology in the sense of amplification. So, for example, amplification of the probe using the second resonator is still limited by non-ideal microwave amplifiers. But even in this situation, we can hope to go out to detect up to 10 photons without destroying the state of the photon, which obviously goes beyond what is possible with optical systems. So now experiments are in progress on this, and what we hope is first of all to look at quantum jumps of the number of photons in an electrical circuit. So similar experiments have been done in the context of cavity QED and also with trapped electrons, and then we want to look at multi-level quantum logics. And also we are very, very much driven by questions like, for example, is it possible to detect as well propagating photons? So in this case, actually, I talked about photons which are trapped in a circuit. Now if you look at propagating photons, there are other issues coming in. And then also, yeah, what is the optimal circuit to reach very strong coupling? So this I would like to summarize. So I talked about the principle of superconducting circuits, two qubit gates, and then quantum non-demolition measurements. And I would like to thank my group and also our funding.